Like many of you, I've got a bit of a backlog. Well, maybe more than a bit. Considering I've been subscribed to Humble Choice since well before it rebranded from Humble Monthly, I've been getting new games faster than I can physically beat them for a long time. I think it's time I start making a dent, don't you? So what I'm going to be doing is taking a game from my backlog, sometimes randomly, sometimes one I've been putting off, I'm going to play it, beat it, and make a video about it. It'll be more detailed than a first impressions video, but not quite a full review. I'll only be talking about the stuff that really caught my attention. The goal here is to enjoy some great games that I probably should have played a long time ago. Hopefully, I can find a couple hidden gems along the way. And the best part? These will be bonus uploads on my channel. As you may know, I upload a video essay every Monday. As you may have noticed, this video was not uploaded on a Monday. I won't be keeping a strict schedule for this series, but as I finish these videos, they'll be uploaded on the following Friday. My goal is to get these out every 2 weeks, but I'm not gonna force it. In any case, let's get started. First up, we've got Book of Demons, an indie title by ThingTrunk. Book of Demons is described as a deck-building hack-and-slash game. I don't think it's the best way to describe it, but I'll get into that a bit later. So the first thing that immediately grabbed my attention was the visual presentation. The entire game has this really neat aesthetic that's meant to look like a pop-up book. Everything looks like paper cutouts, and they got these stiff little animations to complement that. I find this clever because not only does it go along with the whole pop-up vibe, but simple hopping rather than full-blown animated models probably saved a bit of time and money during the development process. The game also has this weird blend of serious and humorous, which was on full display in the intro sequence, which was absolutely wonderful, by the way. They have this dark, evil antagonist, but at the same time you see the devil in hell sitting in a lake of fire playing with a rubber ducky. Now, that got a bit of a giggle out of me, but throughout my entire playthrough, I got the impression that the game was unwilling to commit to being serious or lighthearted. To be clear, focusing on one aspect doesn't mean you have to ignore the other. In fact, a little bit of contrast is a common writing tactic used by the very best. I just feel like by trying to play both angles, Book of Demons lost the ability to really excel at either. I wouldn't say the narrative presentation was bad, but there was definitely some missed potential. The gameplay is where things got interesting. As I mentioned, the developers described the game as a fusion between a deck builder and a hack and slash. Well, it's definitely a hack and slash, and it has cards, but deck builder? Yeah, not so sure about that one. Now, I'm not the hugest fan of hack and slash in general. Typically speaking, I'll get into one for a bit, but fall off pretty quickly, especially since so much of the genre feels so similar to me. Book of Demons plays much differently from any of the admittedly few hack and slash games I've played. The most in-your-face change is the fact that your character's movement is pretty heavily restricted. The randomly generated levels are laid out like an isometric labyrinth, and your character must stay on the path, though some enemies move more freely. You can attack the enemies by clicking on them. The goal is to get to the end of the dungeon, but you're rewarded for fully clearing the area of enemies and loot. As you'd expect, you have a health and a mana pool, which can be increased by finding scrolls in the dungeon and through level up. One thing I really do have to give praise for is how they handled mana. In most of the fantasy games I've played, and not just hack and slash, upgrading mana kind of becomes useless after a point, especially for warrior type classes since they typically won't use many spells. The way Book of Demons does it is they have mana act not only as the cost for spells and abilities, but equipment has a max mana cost. So let's say you have 20 mana and a piece of equipment has a cost of 8. As long as you wear that equipment, your max mana is now 12. It's a neat system and I found myself actually wanting to upgrade mana more often than health, which is very much outside my normal way of playing. And this is especially important because some equipment is absolutely game-changing. Anything you want to have ready, whether it be abilities, items, or equipment, is placed on an action bar at the bottom of the screen. You can unlock more slots as you play, and you'll get them all before too long. Once I got past the initial mini-grind for money, stats, and equipment, I found myself taking 2 or 3 slots for abilities and items, and the rest for equipment. And I know I just said it, but some of these pieces of equipment really make a difference. For example, the bloody armor makes it so you have a chance to drop hearts when you take damage, effectively making you much, much more tanky. But this does go back to the original description of the game as a deck builder. See, the items, abilities, and gear are all represented as cards that you find throughout the dungeon. The only real deck building element comes when you're deciding what to equip, which you probably won't be changing for quite some time. This isn't bad game design, but it does seem somewhat misleading to market the game as a deck builder, and if I went in expecting more of that type of thing, I'd have left disappointed. During combat itself, I noticed that the game actually requires a decent amount of active mouse input. Again, my experience with hack and slash is limited, but from what I've played, I mostly remember just aimlessly clicking to cleave my way through hordes of enemies. In Book of Demons, there's a lot of stuff to click around on. For example, when you're poisoned, you can clear it after a while by clicking on your health bar. When you're stunned, you need to move your mouse onto these flying stars to recover, and you may have to click on some of your equipment, which can become temporarily disabled. Some enemies have shields, which you need to position your mouse on top of before your attacks will do any damage. Many enemies can channel abilities, which range from mildly annoying to oh god, oh fuck. They also become immune to damage during the channel, which you can interrupt by clicking and holding the little bubble above their head. There's just a lot to do on a mechanical level, but nothing too ridiculous. For me, I found that it was engaging, but not particularly overwhelming. Aside from the three main bosses, the game also has mini-bosses, and you'll usually encounter 1 to 3 per floor. These guys are elite versions of normal enemies, and their distinguishing factor, aside from just generally being stronger, is that they have multiple phases. Each phase will have a certain condition to clear. Most commonly, it's to just deplete their health as you'd normally do. However, you might instead have to kill some guardian minions or stay close to the boss for a certain amount of time. These guys can be kinda scary, especially if you're already dealing with a horde of enemies. But more importantly, they break up the monotony, and a lot of times you'll have to actively react and strategize to deal with them without taking more damage than you'd like. The main story only took me a few hours to complete, but I don't mind because I find that Book of Demons shines in its post-game. At this point, by playing the game, you'll start unlocking higher difficulties and can basically traverse dungeons at will. These difficulties start adding a few new mechanics that I personally feel make the game a lot more interesting. The first is that bosses will now curse some of your cards when you encounter them, essentially making them useless until you kill the boss. The other mechanic is the game will force you to have certain cards on your action bar until the end of that set of floors. This is kinda cool because it gets me to use different equipment and maybe find something I like. But it also makes me have to adapt to my new situation. Maybe it'll give me an item or ability that I'll never use, or maybe it's something that I need to try to find some sort of synergy with. Also, the whole curse mechanic makes bosses much more of a threat overall, and it makes it so you really don't want to just leave the boss and come back to it. You want that curse cleared. Although, this also makes the relative danger of the bosses vary wildly. See, the bosses can actually curse cards that you haven't equipped. So if a boss curses 3 cards that you're not using, it's like the mechanic doesn't even exist. However, I encountered a boss that cursed my 2 best pieces of equipment and my health potion, which was a little scary. I think I'd actually like it more if they could normalize this experience a bit. Especially once you unlock a shitload of cards, the chances of these bosses ever cursing something vital goes down. I mean, honestly, as long as the boss doesn't curse my health potion, I usually have 0 issues. Now, one thing I do have to criticize is that so far, the game is actually pretty easy. And keep in mind, this is from the perspective of someone who does not regularly play hack and slash games, so it's not like I'm particularly skilled. I've been playing the post-game as a warrior, and I'm currently working my way through the Nightmare difficulty, which is the 2nd highest on offer. It takes a decent amount of grind to get to this point, so I've been playing the game for a hot minute. I have not died once, and it's not because I'm some god at this game. Honestly, with a few good pieces of equipment, there really isn't much risk of dying. There were a handful of touch-and-go moments, but between my bloody armor, which I really cannot overstate how OP that thing is, my health potion, which once fully upgraded can carry up to 15 charges, each worth nearly my entire health bar, and the fountain scattered throughout that can heal you to full, it's really not that hard to stay alive. That makes this game, which already is pretty grindy by its nature, feel like even more of a grind. Again, this may just be because I'm not too experienced with this genre, as I know a lot of players love grinding their favorite hack and slash, but it makes me feel like this game ultimately gets more boring than it could be. So I picked Book of Demons pretty much at random. I clicked on it, checked out the description, and figured, what the hell? And I'm definitely glad I did. Of course, the game does have its issues, which I've already mentioned, but the core gameplay is fun, and I'm probably going to be playing it off and on for a while. There's quite a bit of grind ahead of me, but I do genuinely enjoy the gameplay loop, so while I don't see myself no-lifing it, I may passively chip away at it over time. Overall, this is a good game, and my backlog is now the tiniest bit smaller. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, don't forget to leave a like and subscribe if you want to see more. Don't forget to check back in on Monday for another new video. Follow me on Twitter at AdsTweets for updates and memes, and follow me on Twitch at AdsGames where I like to stream my editing sessions. I'm not sure if I'll be editing these bonus videos on stream, but for sure I'll be streaming my normal uploads. Once again, thank you all for watching, and I'll see you on Monday. Get the road, Jack, and don't you come back no more, no more, no more, no more.